Okay, cool. Now more of the same, Professor Reinhardt continues his story of the effective theories. Please, go ahead.
Well, let's now try to understand why these vortices produce confinement. Well, I sketched here some typical vortex which you find after center projection in three dimensions. And I have left out here one spatial dimension, so what I assume is that this is the time axis, and the other two axes are spatial axes. Now when you have such vortices, they appear on the plane in the universe as intersection points. Okay? Now the point is, when you have such calculated vortices, these intersection points are completely uncorrelated. They are random. And now it's very easy to see if you have, for example, a time-space plane of the universe, and you put here a temporal Wilson loop inside this plane, that these random intersection points produce an area law for the Wilson loop. And let's illustrate this with me. So we have here a Wilson loop, we have here a plane in our universe, its length L times L, and we put here a Wilson loop inside this plane. Now when you have a single, when you have now these vortices, you have these randomly distributed intersection points. Now let's consider what happens if we have a single vortex, a single intersection point. Now the probability that this intersection point is inside the area of the Wilson loop is just given by the ratio of the area of the Wilson loop to the total area of your plane in the universe. So it's A over L square. Now the probability that this intersection point or this vortex does not is not inside the Wilson loop is then given by the area outside the Wilson loop divided by the total area, which is L square minus A divided by L square. Now when you have two intersection points, the probability that both intersect the Wilson loop is then taking the probability for one intersection point squared. The same is if two intersection points do not intersect the Wilson loop. And if you have two intersection points and one of them intersects the Wilson loop, the probability for that is given here by this expression. You have the probability that the one vortex intersects the Wilson loop, the other does not, and then you have a factor of two because you can compute these two vortices. Now, as you can write here in this form, and now you can extend this to n intersection points. N intersection points, you get, so I assume I have little n intersection points intersecting the area of the Wilson loop and capital N total intersection points. Now the probability that little n vortices intersect this area of the Wilson loop is then given by this binomial distribution. Now you can calculate this probability, the Wilson loop, by just taking the contribution, by taking the probability that these little n vortices pierce the Wilson loop and multiply this probability with the contribution of this n little vortices to the Wilson loop. And as we saw, a vortex contributes the non-trivial center element to the Wilson loop. Now if I have these n vortices, I get the contribution minus n to the minus 1 to the power n. Now I sum over all possibilities, that is no vortex intersecting the Wilson loop, and in the end that all vortices intersecting the Wilson loop. So I can carry out the sum. This is an ordinary and useful binomial formula, and I get here this expression. Now let me introduce the central vortex density, which is defined here in this plane by the number of intersection points over the area of our lattice universe. And now let me keep this vortex density fixed and take the limit where n goes to infinity, and then I get this exponential and I get the area law with the string tension given by twice the vortex density. So this random vortex picture naturally leads to the area law. I mean, this was, it's been known for a long time. The people here, the pioneers in this random vortex picture are Mack and Tuft, basically. What you can do on the, when you have this area, of course, you get the linearizing potential. Now you can measure the vortex density on the lattice. And if you take as input into lattice calculation to fix the scale, this ordinary 440 MeV squared, then what you find for the vortex density is this expression, which when you calculate from that the string tension in this random vortex model, you get a larger value than you have put in. And what you can show is that this larger value arises because the real vortices have correlations, which I did not include it here. If I put here into this picture correlations, I will reduce the string tension. And in fact, we have shown here in this paper there are vortex correlations which have the proper scaling behavior, so that they are physical, and you can attribute this difference between your input string tension and what you get out from this random vortex picture to the correlations between the physical center vortices which you have in your Daniels ensemble.
So what is then, the distribution is not anymore binomial?
No, of course not. The correlated one is not. No. I mean, this is a difficult question, a dynamic question, you cannot easily answer. I mean, you can measure correlation functions, that's what we did. And then you find really correlations which also have the proper scaling behavior. Now, this is a picture and calculation from we did the Turing many years ago, where you shows here that the vortex density which you measure on the lattice has the proper scaling behavior. So it's a physical object in a sense. Now let's try to understand in this vortex picture also the deconfinement phase transition. And in the random vortex picture naturally produces this area law. Let's see whether we can also understand the deconfinement phase transition in this vortex picture. Let me remind you again of this formulation of gauge theory at finite temperature. This transparency I showed before. There's always some noise, I'm sorry.
It's okay.
You have here for the partition function, we have this function integral with periodic boundary condition in the time direction. And as I mentioned before, this boundary conditions basically conductify your time axis circle. And the length of the circle is the inverse temperature. This you all know. Now consider our central vortices in this Euclidean space at finite temperature. I mentioned already that the vortices have a certain thickness. Now, when you increase the temperature, that means you lower this extent of the spatial direction. At some point, the vortices are too fat to fit into this lattice universe. So what the vortices will do, they will align along the time axis. And so what's shown here in this picture, so at some point when there is a critical area where these thick vortices do no longer fit in this in our lattice universe, unless these vortices align along the time axis. And in fact, you can estimate the critical temperature from the thickness of these vortices. It's clear when this L becomes equal to the thickness, there should be somehow the critical temperature. And if you take this 0.8 Fermi, which I mentioned before, and you calculate it or express it in the temperature, you get something like 250 MeV, which is the right order for the critical temperature in pure Young-Mid theory. So this picture you can support by lattice calculation, which was done here in this paper. And I think it gives you a natural explanation of the deconfinement phase transition. Now, let me show you what you see on the lattice if you check this picture. What is shown here is the distribution of center vortices in a subspace of our four-dimensional lattice universe, where we keep one spatial coordinate fixed. So this has the time axis and two spatial axes. Now at zero temperature, you see that these vortices are basically distributed randomly over the whole universe. And now on the right hand side, you have the same picture at high temperature, above the deconfinement phase transition. And what you see is that, most of the vortices there are just parallel to the time axis. So in the spatial plane, you still have random vortex intersection points, but along the time axis, you don't have it, as I will show more on the next transparency. I show again here this picture, which I showed before. We have here two spatial axes. So we have a spatial plane here, and here I have the time axis and one spatial axis. Now, at zero temperature, we saw, above the critical temperature, we saw that vortices basically align along the time direction. Now, you can have fluctuations that these vortices intersect with a time-space plane. And if I consider a temporal Wilson loop in this plane, I will usually get pairs of intersection points. Now, if I have two intersection points, two vortices, they give the center element square, which is one, which is the same contribution as no vortex. So inside the Wilson loop, I get pairs of center vortices, which do not contribute to the Wilson loop. I get a non-trivial contribution only if this pair happens to be near the surface, because then there's a good chance that one vortex is outside the loop and one vortex is inside the loop. So you get only contributions along the perimeter here, and you get a perimeter line. While in the, for the spatial loops, you still have random intersection points, you still have a spatial spring tension. So what you get in this picture, you find above the deconfinement phase transition, the temporal spring tension is gone, the spatial spring tension is still there, and this is what you also find in the full lattice calculation. So this is again here summarized. At t equals zero, we have intersection points, random intersection points, both in the spatial and temporal planes at large temperature, above the critical temperature, where the vortices basically align the time axis. We have random intersection points only along the perimeter of the temporal Wilson loop, and we get the perimeter law. Now, what is shown here is the distribution of vortex matter on the lattice, which you find after center. Yeah.
I was puzzled by that. I mean, there is a profound change in the topography when you reach this line.
Yeah.
Because these vortices seem to be all aligned, and before they are perfectly unhandled. Is there?
You don't have to pay a price for that. I mean, there is no conservation, there is no topological number which is conserved, which
is
whatever the temperature.
No, I mean, you can, you could calculate, I guess, the topological charge or
there must be some topological number which,
yeah,
which is conserved.
Look, let me first
explain the topological properties of
these objects. And,
okay.
Observe.
Thank you. So what's
shown here is
distribution of central vortex mapper
according to the size of the vortex cluster to which they belong to this vortex mapper. And this is in the confined phase, and what you see here is that most of the central vortex mapper belongs to a big cluster which extends basically over the whole universe. While in the deconfined regime, you find.
Yeah, sorry, to interrupt you. Yeah. I'm going back to the last picture again. Maybe this question is completely nuts, but could I, what you explained just before, somehow also relate to the phenomenon of Hawking radiation?
No, this has nothing to do with Hawking radiation. At least I don't see any analogy at the moment.
Okay,
just. Maybe there's some
deeper, I don't know. Maybe there is.
Yeah, maybe I don't know. Maybe I can answer this question. I'm sorry. Maybe it's a good question to investigate for you young guys. So I mean, now in the confined phase, what we find is that most of the center vortex mapper belongs to these small vortex clusters, and these are the short vortices which are parallel to the time axis because they are short at high temperatures. So this is all what we find here consistent with the picture I presented before. Now for SU3 there comes a new subject, because for SU3 we have two non-trivial center elements, and we have therefore also two species of center vortices. What is it belonging to this center element, and what is it belonging to this center element? Now the point is that the square of this center element gives the other one. And this manifests itself in this vortex structure, that two of these vortices can fuse to form such a vortex. So in SU3, you have vortex splitting and vortex fusion. Now this has not been studied on the lattice in the Young-Mills ensemble, but we have studied this in the central vortex model, which I have no time to explain here. But at least let me tell you, this central vortex model, basically what we do, we simulate the vortex ensemble, we use the Nambu-Goto term,
the curvature term,
and then we simulate on the computer, this model, we can calculate the spatial string tension, the temporal string tension as function of the temperature, and we get the increase of the spatial string tension above DC. The temporal string tension drops to zero. So everything comes out basically correctly.
Now, in
this model, what we studied was this vortex
branching.
And what you can do, you can, for example, count the links, how many vortex brackets are attached to a link. Now, this is now done on the so-called dual lattice, these calculations. Now, if there's no vortex bracket of, there's no bracket with a non-zero center element attached to the link, of course, there's no vortex link. There cannot be the case that there's only one bracket, because it would correspond to an open vortex which cannot exist, vortices are closed. Then in ordinary, central vortex is attached to two, the link is then attached to two vortex brackets. And if we have three vortex brackets attached to the link, then we have vortex splitting. The
The same, you can convince
yourself on cross for 5, but not for 4. For 4 you have just vortex crossing and no vortex splitting. And now you can measure how many links you find with 2 vortex plaquettes attached to it, with 3 and so on. And this is calculated here, this model, at 0 temperature. So what you find, most of course the links are just attached to ordinary vortices without branching, but there's a lot of vortex branching here, because when your link is attached to 3 plaquettes, then we saw there is vortex branching, and this also still with 5, 4 is no vortex branching, only crossing. So here we have on this axis is number of vortex plaquettes attached to a link, and here we give the number of links we find with this property. Now if you go now to finite temperatures above,
you can find the phase transition,
and what you do now is keep one spatial coordinate fixed and looks at the same property as before. In a 3-dimensional volume where you have time and 2 space
axes.
And then you find these vortex fusion and splitting, which you had here for 3 and 5, it's gone here. Above the deconfinement phase transition, it's gone. On the other hand, if you fix the temporal coordinate and look at the spatial subspace, you still have this vortex splitting, because we have a non-zero number here at 3 and 5.
And there it has to be, because
this is the part where you have the spatial spin tension, that you still should see the same property as at zero temperature. Because the spatial spin tension is non-zero above the confinement phase transition. So one could, from this behavior, somehow conjecture that the first order character of the SU3, the confinement phase transition, is due to this vortex branching. This vortex branching you have, of course, also in higher SUN groups, but you don't have it in SU2. So this could be an accident that the first order phase transition comes always with vortex branching, but it could also mean something. So at the moment this is open. So, what I have explained now is that this vortex model also explains not only the confinement, but also the confinement phase transition. Now let's ask the question, can this model also explain chiral symmetry breaking? And for chiral symmetry breaking, what is important is that the topological properties of these objects. Now, you know, the gauge fields are classified according to the Pontryagin index or second Schirm class. And when you introduce the electric and magnetic color fields in the usual way, then this topological charge is nothing but the scalar product between the electric and the magnetic field. Now, when you look at these vortices which you get after center projection, they are parts of, there are basically 2 types of vortices. Or, I mean, these 2 types basically emerged as part of a big vortex cluster. They are magnetic vortices, which in 3 dimension form a closed magnetic flux line, which evolve in time, so they exist over some finite time interval. And then there are so-called electric vortices, which exist single time instant. So these are closed surfaces in 4-dimensional space which exist, and they are also closed surfaces in 3-dimension, but which exist only at a single time instant. While these magnetic vortices, they evolve in time and form some tube, whatever. Now you have seen the topological charge is given by the scalar product between the electric and magnetic charge. If you want to have a non-zero Pontryagin index, you need obviously both parts of the central vortices. You need electric and magnetic ones. So if you have an intersection of an electric and a magnetic vortex, then you get a contribution to this integrand of the Pontryagin index. And what you can show rigorously is that the topological charge of the center vortices is given by the self-intersection number of these closed vortex surfaces in four dimensions. This is like the self-intersection number. The sigma denotes a vortex surface.
I mean, in three dimensions.
Surface can intersect with a line. In four dimensions, you get intersection points from the intersection of two surfaces. Okay? So in four dimensions, the center vortices intersect in points, and the topological charge is precisely given by this expression, which looks so innocent, but it is not so, as we see in a second. Now, let's look at this intersection of a magnetic with an electric center vortex. Assume these vortices are both oriented. So you have a magnetic one where the electric field is showing outside, it's basically normal to the vortex surface, and you have a magnetic vortex where the magnetic field point of is directed tangent to this vortex loop. Now where they intersect, you have a non-zero scalar product, as I have shown before. However, the point is, when you look carefully at this picture, the electric field is here directed outward, and the magnetic field is also directed outward, so they get a positive contribution here from this intersection point. However, here, from the second intersection point, the electric field points downwards, while the magnetic field points upwards, and the contribution of these two intersection points cancel. In fact, what you can show
mathematically
is that in four dimensions, the self-intersection number of closed-oriented surfaces vanishes. So, where is then the topological charge of the center vortices if closed-oriented surfaces have zero intersection number? Obviously, you can only escape this if you have one-oriented vortices. Now let's assume, for example, that we change the orientation of the magnetic vortex loop. So let's here at some point change the orientation, so the magnetic field shows here in this direction and here it shows in this direction. What now happens is that here the electric and magnetic field is parallel and here it's also parallel, so these two
intersection points now
act coherently and give a non-zero topological charge. The same you can show when you change the orientation of the electric vortex. So in this case, we get intersection number 2. Now, these vortices, you can have, or you can make them not oriented, for example, by having a surface here, a closed surface like the Klein bottle, which is the analog of this Möbius strip, which you have now in three dimensions. But we may ask for the more physical aspect. What makes the magnetic, or what makes these vortices not oriented in our young Niels ensemble? Because we see these topological properties are crucial for chiral symmetry breaking. Now, for this purpose, let's consider a magnetic monopole and an anti-monopole. So, here is a monopole, an anti-monopole, and they are connected with the Dirac string. Now, the Dirac string is not observable. But let's do the following. The Dirac string represents some magnetic flux. Let's split this flux in two parts. What you get then, half of the Dirac string is nothing but the center vortex. And what you see now is when you have a magnetic monopole on the center vortex, the orientation is changed. So what changes the orientation of the center vortices are magnetic monopoles. And in four dimensions, where these vortices are closed surfaces, the magnetic monopoles form closed loops, which are on these center vortices after we do this abelian and center projection. So I explained to you what one can in fact show rigorously is that the Pontryagin index of center vortices is given by the linking number of the magnetic monopole loops and the center vortex surfaces. So this is a rigorous statement. We see there is a quite close relation between center vortices and magnetic monopoles. The magnetic monopoles are needed for center vortices to give them a non-trivial topological charge. On the other hand, we see that the magnetic monopoles are more naturally can arise when we change the orientation of the center vortices. Now, I mean the fact that the magnetic monopoles are important for the topology of the center vortices should not come with a big surprise, because what one can show is that this Pontryagin index can be expressed completely in terms of the magnetic monopoles if you go to these abelian gauges. And this is shown here in the paper here by myself, was later shown also by other people. You can express the Pontryagin index exactly as the sum of all magnetic monopoles that you find after abelian projection in your Young-Niels ensemble, where this M is the magnetic charge of the monopole, which is topologically quantized. And then there is another integer, which I have no time to explain now. How much time do I have?
Half an hour.
Half an hour, very good. So, there are two types of intersection points. There are intersection points. Remember, the intersection, the topological charge of these center vortices was given by one quarter of the same intersection number of these vortex sheets. Now there are intersection points which contribute one half. You may ask, how do you get then an integer Pontryagin index? Because it's not so difficult to understand. First, you can show that in closed surfaces, the interaction points become pairwise. So that if each intersection points give one half, then you get an integer topological charge. But there are also so-called rising points, which contribute less than one half. The point is, I wrote here the expression for this intersection number in the continuum in four dimensions. Basically, you have here the integral over the when you have intersection between two surfaces, what one surface and another surface, and there's the delta function in between. But at these intersection points here, which contribute one half, you basically get the contribution from the delta function. The argument vanishes at where the parameterization here that you choose for the center vortices is not the same. You have basically two different patches of the vortex which intersect. While here in this case, the vortex is twisted in such a way that all four independent directions which you need in order to have here a non-zero somehow come out here at these isolated so-called rising points. You can easily understand this on the lattice. On the lattice, what you have to do, or you can show then that this Pontryagin index is given by the number of plaquettes at the orthogonal plaquettes at the intersection point. Oops, thank you. Divided by 1 over, or multiplied by 1 by 1 over 32. Now here at this intersection point you have here four plaquettes. the dashed direction here is the time, the full directions are the three spatial directions, and you have here four plaquettes, which extend in the time direction and in one space direction, and then you have four plaquettes, which extend only in the time direction, and when you intersect here, you have 4 times 4 over 32, which gives 1/2. Now in this case here, we have two plaquettes attached to this intersection point or rising point, which extend in the time direction and the space direction, and then you have two here, which extend only in the space direction. You get 2 by 2, you get 1/8 to the intersection number. Now this is a closed vortex sheet in 4 dimensions. This is illustrated in the way that the time is running along this direction, and the vortex is shown here at several time steps. So at one time step you have here this kind of vortex, here we have this crossing of the vortex, is another one. Now when you plot this, or when you analyze this vortex configuration, and you find, for example, here -1/8, -1/8, +1/2, -1/8, and so on. And the intersection of, you can really analyze all these intersection points and can calculate explicitly the center vortices, there's the topological charge. Now, when you plot this vortex in three-dimensional space as a function of time, what happens here is, at some point, the vortex loop emerges out of the vacuum, then this part of the vortex intersects with this part of the vortex, and eventually this vortex loop again disappears. So I mean, this vortex sheet here in four dimensions emerges as a time evolution of closed vortex loops in three dimensions. What you can then show is that you can express this Pontryagin index also as integral over the time derivative of the so-called rising number. I should perhaps not spend too much time here because it needs some. Now I have to explain what the rising number is. It's given in terms of the so-called Gaussian self-linking number, and there is a piece left which is so-called torsion, but let me forget this. It's perhaps not useful to discuss here in detail. Now, let me come to chiral symmetry breaking at center vortices. What I have shown here is a Dirac equation for the quarks, psi is the quark field, d is the covariant derivative with the gauge field. Now, what you know is when you look at the eigenfunctions of this covariant derivative, if you have some eigenvector psi, then when you multiply this eigenvector with gamma 5, you get also an eigenvector which gives, however, the negative eigenvalue. And the fact is easy to see because this gamma 5 anti-commutes with all these Dirac matrices which are here in the Dirac equation for quarks. Now, this fact here can be used that zero modes can be constructed as left or right handed modes, just by superposing these two conditions, these two solutions. So, I mean, you have, then you know from the so-called index theorem that the topological charge of the gauge field is given by the difference of the left-handed zero Dirac eigenmodes minus the right-handed Dirac eigenmodes. So the zero eigenmodes are somehow related to topology. And if you have a non-trivial topology, then you get definitely also zero eigenmodes of the quarks. Now what you can do, what has been done here in this picture, you can investigate the eigenmodes, the quark eigenmodes, in the presence of center vortices. And as you have seen before, in order to have non-trivial topological charge, you need intersecting center vortices. And what is shown here are two pairs of intersecting vortex sheets. And plotted is the
module
of the zero Dirac Einmodes in these two intersecting center vortex sheets. And what you see is that the Einmodes are first of all concentrated along these vortex sheets, and in particular on the intersection points. So the center vortex vortices
somehow act as fermion guides, as quark guides
here in the QCD vacuum. Now this is a calculation that we constructed the center vortices by hand
in the continuum,
and then calculate the zero modes in this vortex background in the continuum. You can also do this on the lattice, and this was much later than done here by the Vienna group. And basically you find the same picture, except
since you're on the lattice, you
somehow smear out the vortices or the fermion modes. I mean, if you compare, we have here basically the ideal picture, because in the continuum, the center vortices, which we put in here, are really on an ideal vortex sheet, while on the lattice, you have vortices which are somehow smeared out. But you see, basically what they have identified here are vortex configuration, which are exactly the same as this one. And then they find fermion zero modes, which are distributed also along the vortices, and in particular at this intersection points. So the lesson is that these center vortices somehow act as quark guides in the Jan-Mietz vacuum. Now you know there is this famous Banks-Kescher relation, which tells you that the quark condensate is given by the density of quark modes at zero virtuality. And virtuality means here it refers to the eigenvalues of the quark Dirac operator. Now this basically is the spectral density, so rho times the rho of lambda, the eigenvalue times d lambda, the number of states here in this interval. And in order to have a non-zero quark condensate due to this relation, you need a non-zero density of Dirac states at here zero virtuality. Now, this is a work done with Gartner, also a PhD student in my group, and with Gattlinger in Graz, who provided the Dirac operator. And what is shown here is the calculation of the spectrum, or the distribution of the eigenvalues of the Dirac modes in the lattice calculation, SV2 lattice calculation. And what has been used here are the 50 smallest eigenvalues for 10 different configurations. So what you see here in the spectrum, there's in fact a non-zero density near zero, and you get, according to the Banks-Kescher relation, you find then a quark condensate. Now, what happens when you do, when you remove the center vortices from your Jan-Mietz ensemble? What you find then is this distribution of eigenvalues, and there's really a gap here around zero. So the density is gone here, this is zero, and there's no quark condensate. So again, what we find here, that the center vortices are also responsible for chiral baking. But unfortunately, that is not the end of the story. When we did the calculation, we of course also did the center projection and calculated the spectrum, the Dirac quark spectrum, just from the center vortices. And what you find then is a very disappointing picture. you get a gap here, which is even larger. So,
was it wrong what I was saying,
that center vortices produce also chirosymmetry breaking?
Because we did
your center projection, and what we would expect that we should get here the density of states near zero, so that we get, according to the Banks-Cashor relation, a non-zero quark condensate. Now, what we found out was the following. The Dirac operator which was used was not sensitive enough to feel these center-projected vortices which live on brackets. So what we did,
we were smearing out
center vortices, and then we were finding also the corresponding zero modes. Now, a couple of years later, the same calculation was done by the Vienna group. And they used a better Dirac operator. I think they used staggered fermions. And now you see what you get. This is the step one for the full lattice calculation. This is the spectrum which you get when you remove the center vortices. There's this gap which we saw before in our calculations. But now when you do center projection, you really get a high density of states here near zero virtuality. So here in this case, doing center projection, basically to compress the modes near zero virtuality.
So there's again the tendency to give chirosymmetry breaking.
I mean, we saw something similar in the calculation of the quark potential. When we did center projection, we get only the confining part and lost this Coulomb part. And here is the same picture for chirosymmetry breaking. When we remove center vortices, we have this gap here, and there's no chirosymmetry breaking. When we do center projection, we do the center. Chirosymmetry breaking. So this shows that the center vortices, in fact, seems to be not only responsible for confinement, but also for chirosymmetry breaking. Oops. So, how much time do I have?
10 minutes,
okay. So, the conclusion from this part of my lecture is that these center vortices seem to be the infrared dominant field configuration. As I explained here, they provide a rather appealing picture of both confinement and deconfinement. Confinement we get because we have basically these random vortices show up as random intersection points. And deconfinement we get because the center vortices align along the temporal axis, and so they disappear from the time-space planes and can no longer provide us with a temporal string tension. Then what I also showed that these vortices, as long as they oriented, they have zero net topological charge, and for this is a rigorous theorem, it has to be the case. In order to have non-zero topological charge, we need not-oriented vortex sheets. And what makes these vortices not oriented are monopoles. The monopoles form closed loops on these closed vortex sheets, and on these monopole loops, the direction of the flux of the central vortex is reversed. So then I showed that this topological charge is concentrated at the intersection points, and there are various types of intersection points, so-called two intersection points, or transverse intersection points and rising points. And what we can also show is that the topological charge indeed comes always out integer, as it should. And finally, I have shown that these central vortices are responsible for spontaneous breaking of chiral symmetry by looking at the quark spectrum in the center removed case and the center projected case. And what we see, then in one case, there's a gap here near zero virtuality when we remove center vortices, and according to the Banks Kescher relations in chiral symmetry, breaking is gone. The other hand, when we do the center projection, we get, this was the picture I showed here before. Sorry. Sorry, there's something. Yeah, tap this to this. I have to get rid of this. So, where am I? I think I'm here. Yeah, okay. So when we then
central projection will in fact increase
the density of states here near zero virtuality in this confinement. Now if you give me 2 minutes.
Yes,
you okay. Now comes the crucial question. Why are center vortices so important? Is there an explanation why in particular these objects dominate the infrared physics? I think one can give at least some arguments. And what we did, this was a diploma thesis of Dominik Klenge. We studied the energy density of a straight vortex as function of the flux of the vortex. So we take an infinite long magnetic vortex as function of the flux in the vortex. So what you find if you have no quarks is the following. The flux here is so normalized, at zero of course you have no flux, no vortex, at one corresponds to the flux of the central vortex. And what you find in the gluon sector is that the central vortex is degenerate with the vacuum. This, of course, is not surprising because the gluons are principal central vortex prime, center prime. Now, if you include quarks, what you find then is that the center vortices are no longer degenerate with the vacuum. However, they still form a minimum in the energy density as function of the flux. So this, in my opinion, gives some explanation why these central vortices dominate the infrared physics in Young-Mills theory. So, thank you.
Transition. The crucial point was that these vortices align. So, do you have a reason why they align?
I mean, the only reason I can think of is that they are too fat to fit anymore
in the universe when the temperature is large enough, because the temporal extent of the
universe is given by the universe temperature. Mm-hmm. So, at some point, there
can't be vortices in this plate.
See, and the present evidence for this fact that they align is that.
Yeah, I mean, I saw this picture, where we measure the distribution of vortices on the lattice. Maybe I'll find it here. It will take some time, but it be. What should come? Oops. Okay. Yeah. You see, in the confined phase, most of the vortex matter belongs to a big vortex cluster. In the deconfined phase, what we find that most of the vortex matter enclose small vortices. And these small vortices are precisely the ones which go along the time direction which is short. So I mean, we have lattice evidence for that.
Okay, thank you. Questions? Okay, let's example first, Giro second.
A quick question. I mean, what's the interplay between the center vortices and the instant ones in the context of pilot symmetry information?
I don't know. Instant ones, I mean, can see what you can do? Can construct from instant ones monomical configurations. But I don't see how you get just center vortices from instant ones.
No, but we don't need center vortices for pilot symmetry breaking, right?
Yeah, okay.
Instant one will do the job.
Yeah, okay. So
the
question is that with the instant ones you can get pilots in.
Yes.
Yeah. But you see, how do you get pilots in maybe from the instant ones? You use this instant one
model.
Then you have some parameters, then you fit the instant one density.
And then
pilotometry breaking you can easily obtain as soon as we have enough correlation.
Well, I guess the topological argument comes in the same way. You calculate zero more than the Dirac.
Yeah, but this is not index tree. I mean, people have, for example, calculated or extracted from the instant or leak model some quantum direction. And this is, they get kind of extended non Hodgkin here. It gives you chiral symmetry breaking right away. So, I mean, the instant ones, I don't see that instant ones are really responsible for chiral symmetry breaking. At least they are not responsible for confinement.
No,
but I mean, we should expand both. Okay.
So you presented the magnetic monopole and anti-magnetic monopole. They are connected through, with the vortices. Now, I think I take the gauge, maximum Abelian gauge, and then one can essentially deduce the effective Lagrangian, starting with the effective Lagrangian and the effective Lagrangian and the dual Ginsburg-Landau theory, which contains the residual gauge field and the monopole field, right? So my question is, how can I, how to, so the center vortices must emerge out of this
From the Abelian theory.
Yes, this effective Ginsburg-Landau theory.
Very good, very good. Very good question, thank you. This has been done. The so-called indirect center gauge fixing. Yeah, one first does Abelian gauge fixing and then center gauge fixing on top of the Abelian one. And you still find the monopoles, you lose some vortices because you do it between some projection, but you can do this. What I did not mention is there's also a work by the Jenner group where they really analyze the magnetic monopoles in the maximal building gauge connection with the center vortices. And there you really see that these vortices are on top of this, the monopoles are on top of these vortices.
Could you give me the relevant references?
I can perhaps stick it out. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, now my stomach allows me to have one question and its answer only. And before, sorry, David was before Christoph, but before I pass mic to David, does any of the students have any questions? We have again having a nice professorial discussion session. Jan, you'll get it. David, your question, Christoph, your questions are postponed to the exercise.
We have 2 weeks stomach. We will not forget this.
I don't think that is, it's a request, a question now, but it's essentially the same what Professor Pazol asked before and kind of what she asked you 10 minutes ago. If there is a consequence that you come from closed vortices lines to aligned vortices lines,
yeah.
Because you have a change in the genus.
No. Wait a second. This is not correct. Because these vortices, even if they align on the time axis, they are close by the W equal magnitude. So we can change the topology. This is an important question, thank you.
Okay, now we conclude this session. Next step is lunch, and we return at 12:30.